Okay, today I'm going to talk about how to use Linux for safety application like automotive. One of the advantages of Linux is that it's open source, but this is also one of the challenges of using Linux for this application. And what I'll try to show today is to show how we can use this application or in automotive and what need to be done in order to make it feasible. My name is Itai Yarom and I'm leading the business activities in MIPS or wave computing. So a few words about MIPS. MIPS had many changes in the last few years, changing some ownerships. But we have a strong history and a strong leadership in this IP business with over a billion chips being shipped almost every year. And we are very strong in several markets, including the automotive market. And why RISC-V is related to MIPS, as was mentioned also in the previous presentation, MIPS has a strong history of ISA and their own instruction set, which is in some sense very similar to RISC-V. And when we look on the ecosystem of RISC-V and the maturity of it, we show the potential of building our next generation ISA based on RISC-V or compliant with RISC-V. Both of those instruction sets coming from the same or similar route with based from the MIPS 4 instruction set. I think RISC-V celebrated recently 10 years and MIPS 4, I think, is over a two decade of history. But it's still been used in some of the exciting system like the satellite that took picture of Pluto and then left the solar system. So we are just about to release our first RISC-V IP core, which already have been used in some selected customers. And this core is very similar to some of the MIPS core that is being already used in some of the automotive system and also running Linux. So if you look on the news, you see a lot of talks about autonomous cars, robot taxis, and things like that. Actually, next year, Mobileye is expected to launch robot taxi services in several places around the world, including in Tel Aviv. And they also have several systems that are considered as a level 2+, which means that it can have adaptive cruise control, but also can change lane and bypass other cars. So doing several things simultaneously, not just keeping the lane, but also changing lane and so forth. The interesting thing about all of the systems that robotaxi is going to be launched next year or already in beta this year, and the L2 systems that are being used by, you can see the example of the car that's been used already by more than 20 cars in the industry. All of the system are running Linux. And this is the first time that we have a Linux running on a MIPS core, but also Linux running in a MIPS core in an automotive a safety system, in a critical safety system, and not just in the infotainment systems. And this is one of the benefits of Linux is that it's a open source. So it's been used and been reviewed by many people. So this should make it easier in some sense to consider it as a safe system. But on the other hand, Linux development flow was developed before there were some guidelines for the automotive industry. And it's not easy to change it or to make it an automotive flow. So what we'll try to show today is how to close those gaps and to achieve some qualification based on the ISO 26262 for SLB for Linux. And we won't touch of some of the IQ5 safety feature that we add in order to help to this qualification. So we use some special safety feature that can be helped. But I have a link here you can follow later on, a talk I have last year on DAC that discussed this in more details. And this part of the qualification is related to chapter four, part eight, chapter 12 in the standard that discussed this software qualification. So here we're going to touch two of the key items we took from the standard and used to achieve this qualification. The first one is the ability to decomposition of the safety qualification effort. And this means that we can different parts of the qualification achieve different level of it. And then with decomposition, we can achieve the required level. So we have in the two example, we have a blue part and we have the other parts in the graph. So the blue part is the one we're going to focus today, how to achieve ASLB for Linux. And then when we go from this level, we can achieve ASLD by decomposition with the safety island in the top example. The safety island is a lockstep that's running RTOS that is ASLD level. And the other option is to use two separate systems that are independent to achieve ASLD by decomposition, both of the system, each one of them running Linux in this case. And actually in the Automotive examples, there are several redundancy or several decomposition of the system to achieve ASLD in much higher level of safety quality. The other part which we mentioned is the part eight of chapter 12. And in order to achieve the ASLB qualification, we need to meet these five criteria. And this is where we're going to focus on in the next slide. But basically we want to have a requirement analysis that is based on the application in the automotive, in the car that we're going to do it, or in the and then we also want to use some a very in-depth code analysis to complete what's being done in the Linux verification environment, looking on some of the kernel structure. And we're going to touch this about separating the safety part of the kernel from the non-safety part of the kernel, and then looking between the connection of those elements. And then we will show how to how all of this connect together. So the first one is what you mentioned is about the requirement. So the requirement is coming from the system requirement. So if you look on the car, and this is an example of requirement. So if you look on the car and we're looking about a memory leakage or address space application and things like that, we want to make sure that there's no issues with that. And then we look on the specific SoC that been used and look on the memory management there. And this requirement go into specific requirement on the operating system and the software running. And this requirement enable to a specific requirement like a glibc malloc qualification or kernel memory qualification. And when we look in all of the requirements coming from the automotive, and this was one example, and then looking on all of these different functions, we can say all of these functions we need to make sure they are being qualified. We put them as a safety related function. And all of the functions that are not being part of this list are not non-safety related requirement, and then we only need to focus on the safety related requirement in a more deeply way of analyzing the flow on them. Okay, so let's look a little bit in more detail to this concept. So from the application itself, we separate it to what part are safety related, and then this implies to the glibc library and then to the Linux kernel. And we separate it basically to safety related, not safety related. There are some relation between the two parts. So there can be a non-safety related function that can influence the state or influence the safety of the system. And we want to look on this part. And in addition to that, we can add some special code or some new code on top of the software we are using in order to address some of the more challenging requirements like memory allocation and so forth. And in order to identify all the safety related function, we are using call tree tools, which can show us all the functions that been related. And in the next slide, I'm going to show some a small example of a call tree, which is reduced in order to fit to this slide. But this is a very detailed work that been done or was being done in order to analyze and define which part we want to focus on. So it's a work that already been implemented and been suggested, and we're going to touch it a little bit later about that. And then after we divided the safety related and non-safety related part of the Linux, then we look on the different interfaces that can corrupt the state of the kernel from going from something happening in the non-safety related function to the kernel. So just to give intuition, in Linux there's a lot of function that help like printf or things like that are very useful, but they are very challenging to qualify, and also they are not needed as part of the operation. They can help in debugging, can help in other activities, but not needed as part of the operation of the environment. So this is part of the function we put as the not safety related function that we want to keep in Linux, but we don't want to put the effort in verifying them. And when we're looking on the different causes that can influence the non-safety related to the safety related, then we see two types. One of them is pointer from the non-safety related to the safety related side. And this is the less likely cause of corruption to the system. And we do some code analysis and some static and stress testing to address this. And the other part is to have some, if there are some direct interfaces, and in this case, we want to come with some mitigation on how to address this issue, if it's memory leakage or build some kind of a way to address it. Here is an example of different relationship between the safety and non-safety related function. This can be a call from a non-safety function to a safety-related function. And then we have a variable that can be corrupted from some issue in the non-safety area that can influence the safety-related behavior. Or it can be a joint variable that is not part of the function, but also can be corrupted. And there's also some of the influence if it's coming from the same device tree. So for each kind of this interference between the two systems, and we want to basically to have a isolation between them or try to look on the different thing in order to analyze each only the safety related part without the non-safety related. and this is what is called a freedom from inference. And in order to do it, we do some kind of analysis that looks something like that. So if, for example, we have a global variable like that, we're looking on the different effect that it can have on the system, and then we look on the different mechanism that can address this effect and mitigate it. So for now, we talk about two main concepts, AC decomposition, and also separating the kernel to safety-related and non-safety-related activity. In this slide, I put the entire flow that also map it to the different ELISA groups. So ELISA is enabling Linux to run on safety application, safety critical application. And this put a wider view of the flow. And I'm not going to go into too much details about each part of it, but this should give some overview about the flow that we use to achieve a Linux qualification. This flow was reviewed by two external reviewers and was approved to be used in those critical systems. And in general, as we mentioned in the one of the slides, the first part is to look at the requirement of the system, and then following this requirement to separate it from safety critical to non-safety critical. Then we're looking on the different partitioning and trying to analyze them. In this part, we're looking on the code analysis, following on some of the requirement. There's what we did, we also looked on some of the, in this working group, we also looked on some of the coding guidance coming from the MISRA-C and coming from other flows. We compare them to the ISO 26262 in order to see what part we want to use. In this part that is part of the, is out of the ELISA focus, but it also needed, we did similar thing for the glibc part that is being used as part of the software and need to be looked on and so forth. So all of this information in more detail is available in the ELISA webpage. And there's also white paper that discuss about the flows and how to use them. Some additional information on the ELISA working group, as I mentioned, is to enable Linux running on safety applications. This is a working group that combined from different companies, from automotive companies to tier one, to this Linux distribution, to other companies and so forth. And the goal is to enable to run it on safety critical system that it's both automotive, but also robotics and other applications. The flow of this and all the focus is being discussed in this working group. And also one of the goals of the activity is to enable that if there are any patents related to the flows that might limit the usage, then all the members donate those patents to the working group so we can use them without any fear that we violate any patent or any usage of that. And in specific, Intel had several patents that they use the patent in order to protect from other people blocking achieving this activity. So it's not to stop, but to enable the working group. And if you have further question or would like to achieve this and would like to get any assistance with that, then you're welcome to contact me. And here is my detail and email address. Okay.
Wonderful, thank you. It looks like we have a couple questions for you and somebody who's out there answering them. So if you can take a look at the Q&A, that would be wonderful. So thank you for your presentation.
Thank you.